He has helped design incentive regulation, transmission planning, electricity market design, natural gas market dynamics, energy efficiency, demand response, the integration of distribution, generation, and variable resources. He has a degree from the University of Delhi, and an MS degree in environmental and regulatory economics from University of Wyoming. All of that by way of saying, really what he is he is a leader when it comes to figuring out the mechanics of how and when microgrids are going to be rolled out in this country, and what it's going to look like, and how you're going to get all that constellation of actors, almost like centrifuges, to start syncing up and really empower all of them to get the most benefit out of this. And so, without further ado, I introduce you to Shiv Mani.
Thank you very much, Drew. Is the mic on? Can you all hear me? Okay, great. So we have a really great panel. We have a great panelist for this discussion, and what I'm going to do is just actually ask them to introduce themselves, and then I'll give you an overview of what our discussion is going to be about. So Ellen, why don't you just go ahead and introduce yourself?
Okay, I'm Ellen Bell with Environmental Defense Fund, which is a nonprofit environmental organization, and I'm going to give a little background because in the Midwest I get the question a lot, what is EDF? So that was established in 1967, and now we have a staff of over 500 scientists, engineers, business professionals, all working to improve the environment through various projects and programs, everything from fishing catch shares to climate change. And one of the things that makes EDF unique is that we work with companies to advance energy efficiency and energy management. We've done various programs since the early 90s with McDonald's, taking them from the styrofoam clamshell to the paper products that did a great deal to take waste out of the landfills. And what I do is I work with their climate core and clean energy programs. We focus on commercial real estate, specifically in the city of Chicago, and helping portfolios and buildings advance their energy management goals. I've been with the organization for 2 years. And when I came, I did not know what Climate Corps was, but what I discovered was that it was created to bridge the gap between the financial possibilities that were available with energy efficiency and the fact that they weren't translated correctly to the audiences that would actually implement them. So Climate Corps was created to do just that, and it's done that with companies from Google to organizations and municipalities like the City of Chicago and portfolios like JLL and Transwestern. And I also am lucky enough to work with the Clean Energy Program, which is focused on transforming the grid, which is obviously a very fancy way of saying that we're looking for ways to incorporate renewables and energy efficiency into the grid so that we move from plant-based old network to one that seamlessly integrates the new technologies that have been discussed here today. And over the last 2 years, I've discovered there's a great deal of opportunity for technologies and interoperability and partnerships in the buildings that I work with, but they aren't often given the opportunity to take advantage of them because it's not presented in a way that speaks to their bottom line, which is, at the end of the day, what they have to worry about. So what we do is we take the time to translate that and make sure we bring the right audience into the room. And I think the reason that I'm sitting here, which I've questioned quite a bit, is the fact that I am the person in the room who has to have the patience to say, I brought you this person, even though you might not understand the technology, and they're going to give you the right pieces to make your building or your organization optimize its efficiencies in a way that also allows you to go to your shareholders, to your C-suite, and explain that you've made them money.
Bram? Thanks,
Sam. Yeah, my name is Bram Reinders. I am from Alliander, the Netherlands. Alliander is the comet. Alliander has 40% of the business of distribution in the Netherlands. And my role is a little bit a special role. I grew into that role, and that is setting up international collaborations. And that's also why I'm here, to work with people from the United States, and in particular also Chicago, to connect the dots with, you know, all kinds of initiatives and issues on clean energy transition between Europe and North America.
Chuck?
Yeah, hi, I'm Chuck Casely. Great to be back in my hometown of Chicago. Live in Kansas City now, work for a vertically integrated investor-owned utility, KCP&L. My boss was just out here talking just a little bit ago. Can speak to a lot of different things that we're going to be discussing today, but I think we are here, and KCP&L is here, to prove that all the cool, progressive, environmentally friendly, and customer-centric ideas don't all have to happen in California in the United States. We can have electric vehicles. We can do demand response. We can make the grid more efficient. We can have and be friendly to distributed generation and solar. And that, given the way the grid was designed, which is to meet peak demand all of the time, every day, all year long, there's a lot of value in making the grid more efficient, and that's kind of what we're exploring, doing that in a customer-centric way. So,
I'm Dave Shepheard. I'm a managing director at Accenture. Formerly, I was with a company called Structure Consulting Group, the Structure Group, Structure. We've done a lot of work in the market around automation solutions and smart grid deployments of operations technology. I rejoined Accenture after a 17-year hiatus back in January. And now one of the roles I play is to look at some more of our transformation opportunities in the distribution sector in particular. So I'm actively involved in the New York REV discussions as well as discussions in California around AB 327 and the creation of DSOs. I also do a lot of work with Accenture in Europe, particularly around some of the more performance and innovation-based regulatory regimes in the UK, in particular around RIIO and some of the low-carbon network funding initiatives. And it's very interesting for me now to be sort of at, 25 years into my career in utility industry and having gone through the deregulation of the generation sector and having gone through the deregulation in competitive sectors within retail supply and seeing the some components of competition and competitive pricing and transmission around new transmission build, particularly to support renewables, grid scale utility renewables generation. And I like to think about, the competition that we see now coming in distribution is more about optimizing outcomes. It's about trying to rethink how the distribution business needs to work within this ecosystem of, renewable generation, battery storage, microgrid technologies, vendor communities, technologies, that are coming to the forefront to provide some of the automation capabilities. So that's a perspective that I hope to bring to the group today.
Hi, John Kelly. I'm with the U.S. Green Business Certification Institute. They just changed the name from building to business because they've really looked at the whole business ecosystem. And I think people own buildings, and it's really a business around supplying a service through a building. It is wholly owned subsidiary of U.S. Green Building Council, and you heard from Brendan earlier today. I am the technical director of a new program at USGBC and GBCI called PEER. And the best way I can explain it is think about your mobile phone. And some of you have a Google, and some of you have an Android, and some of you have an Apple operating system. PEER really serves as a design and operating system for microgrids. So it is really used to give you a better user experience to allow everything to plug into the microgrid from the customer perspective, and then to allow you to buy any possible product from the bulk grid that you want to buy. And I think we're asking everyone to think a little bit differently about how do you build a better operating system around a microgrid. And I'll explain, we have a little different view of what a microgrid is, a little bit more expansive. I'll talk about that later.
And yeah. Good afternoon. My name is Yann Kulp. I work for Schneider Electric. Schneider, we tend to say, is the largest company you have rarely heard of. We're a $30 billion international company. We do energy management. Our tagline is make the most of your energy, and that's all we think about, whether it's a utility or a large commercial industrial or homes, whatever it is. Our goal in life is to reduce that usage, that energy usage, and make it as efficient as possible. And here in the US, we do about a quarter of our business, 25,000 people, 1,300, I think, in Chicagoland. So a big historic footprint with a company we acquired called Square D many, many years ago, a 100-year-old company at least. And I run the business of SmartSpace here in the US. And SmartSpace really means all the things that interact with real people. We do a lot of engineering stuff for other engineers. Those tend to run in the background, in the basement, and we also have home automation, small commercial type solutions that really interface with people who live in those buildings, who work there, and that's what I do.
How does all this? They use a couple of words, like they used ecosystem a couple of times, and then they used what you could call standard jargon. Using all these terms like Internet of Things, microgrid, and so on and so forth. And so how does all that come together in the ecosystem, and what ecosystem are we talking about? So I'm just going to frame our conversation for you, and the best way to frame it is to just actually have you participate. So I'm going to ask you in the middle of the night, when there's a lot of wind out here in the Midwest, a lot of wind resources, and electricity prices are very low, sometimes they're negative, how many of you, show of hands, are familiar with that phenomenon? Okay, so a lot of you are, about maybe a third or even half of you are familiar with that phenomenon. And then you have folks like Chuck, who've, you know, your company has got this big program on electric vehicles. So assuming at some point you're all going to have your electrical vehicles, I don't know which model, but at some point you probably will. How many of you would be interested in charging your vehicle when the prices are the lowest? Show of hands. Okay. So that's basically the sort of the bookends of our conversation. At one end, you have the consumer end, where you're a consumer and you're, you've got a consumer durable, in this case, it's an electric vehicle. But it could be a really small thing. It could be a washing machine or refrigerator. And that's where the Internet of Things discussion begins. And then it could become bigger. It could be your whole house, your air conditioning system, and it could be all these things talking to each other, and you're charging your vehicle. And so you want to optimize that. And then once it goes outside your house, it could be the building or the neighborhood. At lunchtime, we talked about community microgrids. So then it could go expand beyond the neighborhood into microgrids. And then it could go beyond microgrids into smart cities, which is what Bram out here is working on. And then once you go to smart cities, then you have to integrate it with the whole grid, and that goes to the first question that I asked, which was that, well, you know, wholesale power prices are really low in the middle of the night, and how do we optimize our usage so that we take advantage of that? So that's sort of the frame of our discussion. So we're going to start from micro. So we'll start from the smallest thing, which is the Internet of Things, and then we'll just go on, follow this path, and just go to the macro in the next half an hour or so. And but before I say anything further, I am with the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and but I do not represent the views or the opinions of FERC or any other U.S. Government agency. I'm required to make this disclaimer. So all the opinions are my own. So let's start with the Internet of Things, and basically I'm just going to, because again, that's a phrase that has been used a lot, and what does it really mean, and what does it mean in the context of the energy industry? So I'm going to ask maybe Bram if you would like to just give us some idea of, you know, what you think Internet of Things means and what the implications are.
To us, Internet of Things are very smart devices that can talk to each other to the benefit of society. And that is also where smart cities comes in, and not just the physical layer, but also the IT layer and then the social layer. And how can the Internet of Things, how can all these new technologies benefit the consumers, benefit the people in the cities, benefit urbanization?
And so Ellen, he mentioned social in his comments. Could you elaborate on how Internet of Things, which is sort of like a very techie thing, you know, what does it really mean in terms of human adoption? Like, we have so many of these technologies where the technologies are capable of doing a lot of things, but for some reason, we just don't capitalize on the full potential of these technologies. So based on your experience working out here in Chicago with a bunch of buildings and working in the energy efficiency space, can you tell us what we really need to be looking for and what should we be careful about? And I'm going to make this a two-part question because the other part will be for John, and I'd like you to go back to your experience in the past 15 years and look at LEED and all those kinds of things and basically say that, okay, well, this is what we've learned in the past, you know, from your point of view, and what should we be looking out for in terms of these new technologies now? So why don't you start off, Ellen?
The best way I can illustrate what makes all of this valuable is probably to a man, and they're mostly men. I don't think I've come across a female chief engineer yet. All of the gentlemen that I'm lucky enough to work with love their building automation systems to a point, and the biggest one that they always point to is the fact that they hold up their phone and they say, I can control things from this little device. And 20 years ago, even less than that, they had to be in the building on the weekends at all hours. Now they get an alert on their phone that tells them what's going on. It tells them who, should basically take care of it on their staff, and they're able to manage things in a way that has made their life much easier. It's not only made their life easier, but it's cut down on hot and cold calls. So the other human element to the work that I get to do in these buildings is the bottom line is you keep the tenant happy. None of the stuff that we may present to them is worth anything if it upsets their client. So when we integrate making sure that we make their client happy, whether it's through better indoor air quality control or better lighting or anything like that, with the fact that these are a community of industry professionals who know what their building should be doing and how it could do it best, and present these ideas to them in a way that pulls all of that together. We have an opportunity that's really unparalleled to transform the way not only the building operates, but the way it can possibly give back to the grid if we optimize the opportunity for programs like demand response or battery storage when it gets there.
And John, how about you?
So I'll use an analogy. So Dave Collado talked earlier about meters, advanced meters. And so if you think about LEED and PEER as design and operating standards for buildings and microgrids respectively, they each give credits for certain things you do, for better operating systems, for better design. So let's take advanced meters. Within PEER, you only get full credit if you provide direct wireless access of the meter data to the tenants or the customers within your microgrid or your grid. Now look at Pecan Street. They've been studying now what can be done with that data. And if you guys get a chance to go look at the work going on at Pecan Street, what they've shown now is 1 second data can be used by software to actually do virtual energy audits of homes, to determine diagnostics, to actually separate out all the loads so that you don't have to meter each load. You can actually tell which load is which just by disaggregating the data using the 1 second interval data. So I think when we talk about the Internet of Things, it's also what's the standard for how we're gonna share that data between those two devices. So if we block what the capability of the data is, then we can't get the ultimate performance out of the internet and out of software and out of the other end where the data is going.
So what are some of the business models and technologies and so on that you see coming in the future? And the second part of the question, which I'd like others to comment on also, especially Chuck, is that the EPA came up with their Clean Power Plan proposal. And one of the pillars of the Clean Power Plan is, of course, energy efficiency. And the states are supposed to meet these targets that the EPA has come up with. It's a state-by-state target. And so how do you see, has a conversation begun in terms of energy efficiency and using new technologies like the Internet of Things and home automation? So Yann, why don't you?
So I think everybody agrees that technology's there, technology's smart devices, smart sensors in a way that is pretty scary in the amount of data that can be collected and where it can be collected from. And the critical point, as John said, is what do you do with the data and how do you make that relevant to the end user? I'd take it one step further and maybe say that actually what needs to be done is something that is not social, it's antisocial or unsocial, in the sense that at the end of the day, I think that a lot of consumers, and I focus a lot on homeowners, don't really care and don't want to care. And so if you look at a lot of smart cameras and smart locks and smart thermostats and smart everything, there's a lot of a desire to take all this data from the IoT space and make it interesting and actionable and exciting for the homeowner. We've been fortunate to have been deploying about 10,000 homes over the past 2 years with a prior technology. And we've seen the usage rate of the information we provide in terms of meter data and smart thermostats and smart plugs. And I hate to say this, but a first few weeks and then it starts trickling down. Because how often do you really, really, really want to do that disaggregation? And that at some point in time, it becomes overwhelming and not that exciting. And so I think really what's exciting in terms of the IoT space is the automation of that energy, which means I'm going to give directions to the system. I'm going to have data that's pulled in, but it's going to run itself, like cruise control. When you're cruising down the highway at 65, you don't put inputs about, well, you know, what exactly is my speed going up and going down, and how do I want to use my brakes and energy? It's running itself. And I think that's the next step. You know, for the moment, we're talking about social. I think the next step of IoT is going to be kind of the unsocial, you know, the unsocial usage of the IoT.
Sure. And so do you see an agent, like do you see an entrepreneurial entity being responsible for this quote unquote unsocial part? Like who's going to control it?
I have no clue. All I'm saying is that, you know, you see the complexity of a building. And we talked about electric vehicles, solar, real-time pricing, DR programs, efficiency programs, storage, et cetera. There's an infinite number of loads and resources and data points on pricing, whatever. And that becomes unmanageable on a real-time basis. It's not possible, or nobody wants to do it. Unless maybe you're a building engineer and you are interested, for most people, it's impossible. And I don't have an answer.
Sure.
But it's got to happen because it's overwhelming.
I think energy efficiency and demand response are critical. I mean, if you look at the way the grid has been designed for 130 years, it's been designed to meet peak load at a very small duration of time. It just doesn't make any sense anymore to keep designing it to that in that fashion. If you think about it, 130 years ago, the economic value created by electrifying things was immense, so the capital needed to do it and to maintain it wasn't a significant thing because the benefit, the economic benefit of doing it was huge. Now we've reached a point where the economic benefit of the grid and continuing to invest in this organism is declining, but the need isn't necessarily going away to meet increased demand. So I think I couldn't more agree with what Yann was saying and actually what our friends from the Environmental Defense Fund said, which is we know that consumers don't want to think about their energy usage. The average American consumer thinks about it for about 8 minutes a year. And everybody will argue that people would want to do that more, but I'll just ask you a question right now. I assume most of the folks in the audience have a checking account, a banking account. You might even have an investment account, and you can probably get it on this thing right here. And probably some of you have advanced degrees, maybe even in finance. And how many of you have tweaked your portfolio today, or yesterday, or the day before? Because the financial upside from that is a heck of a lot more than tweaking your energy portfolio, where savings and benefits are measured for a residential consumer in pennies. So I think it's absolutely right. People don't want to think about it. People also don't want their lifestyle to be impacted by it. And I think that's where the Internet of Things and where utilities and other bringers of value that create value have to interact. I think utilities have to become a little bit like Apple. Apple decided when they launched their iOS to make that open source software. Anybody can make an app if it meets certain guidelines and put it on the phone. The Apple phone itself is that much more valuable because of all of those apps and all the people who have particular interests and particular passions and particular skill sets bringing that to that platform. I think that's what the grid has to be. The grid has to be iOS 9 or iOS 10. It has to say, we want Schneider. We want environmentally minded folks interacting and making this more efficient. And because I think that's where the real value is. And from a utility perspective, we get in trouble if consumers have their lifestyle impacted. So we have a load curtailment program where literally we have grocery stores turning off lights and turning up air conditioners. And then putting out signs saying, because KCP&L needs electricity today, we're turning up the heat. Well, that's not good for us, and it's not good for the consumer. It may make the grid more efficient, but that's not good, to your point. To your point, unless it can happen automatically, unless it can be seen in real time by the folks who dispatch our generators, then there's not as much value in it for us. What the Internet of Things is, and what working with suppliers and vendors like the folks that are sitting around me, is utilities finally saying, look, we need to be cheap, we need to be reliable, but there is huge value in making the grid more efficient. These guys know how to do it. Let's set up the tolerances and let's make something that is consumer friendly, we don't have to think about, that we can see and manage within the tolerances on our system.
They did talk about in the previous panels and over lunch, they did talk about rate design. And I wanted to bring that in the conversation too. And then we'll also talk about electric vehicles and rate design. But it turns out that Commonwealth Edison, and do they call themselves Commonwealth Edisons or ComEd nowadays? I don't remember.
ComEd.
Okay, ComEd, so I'm kind of old school. They have a real-time pricing program, and is there anyone in the audience who's subscribed to the real-time pricing program? So we have one, two, that's three people. That's pretty good. And it's not a very, that really is pretty good because, you know, there aren't many utilities in the country that have a real-time, they have time of use rates and things like that, but they don't really offer a real-time pricing program. But goes to, so do you keep track of it regularly? Are you an employee of ComEd?
No.
So there are a few people who are interested. But anyway, speaking, you know, moving on to a slightly higher level.
Yeah, sure. Just a comment on the real-time pricing. I mean, I think it's interesting because, you know, real-time pricing typically just sends an energy pricing signal effectively. Mm-hmm. And if you look at this emerging, you know, ecosystem of electric vehicles and battery storage and microgrids. I'm a customer in the Dominion Virginia Power region, and it's not a very popular rate option, but they do have a demand TOU program with smart metering that you can opt into. And it's really effective, again, if you get the right pricing signals out there. And again, it's pretty complex, so it's not for everybody, but if you get the right pricing signals out there to get consumers to actually reduce their demand, in line, you know, at those peak periods, in line with the cost of the infrastructure. So not just the energy component of it that varies, but also trying to get a way to make sure that people are using or paying for their fair slice of the network.
Mm-hmm. We're starting something really interesting here, and I don't know if anybody really does it yet, but if you have some sort of a dynamic pricing rate, and then you have IoT connected devices, smart thermostats, which we do also, now you're enabling that building, whether it's a home or a building, to automate the response to the price signal. Because currently, my boss used to live in Chicago, and he was on the real-time pricing program, and cost of electricity was incredibly cheap at 1 o'clock in the morning. You know, he doesn't have an app on his phone that says, wake up at one, and, you know, turn off your air conditioning or whatever, charge your vehicle. It's not practical, right? But if you have that automation where you have a smart device of some sort that is connected to that, now you can have a building that's starting to work on its own. It's sort of a transactive model that is, I think, a lot more attractive because you set it and forget it, as the great TV sales guy said. Yeah. Right?
So Chuck, at KCP&L, you have this electric vehicle program which your CEO referred to earlier on. But do you also have all the things that go with it or have plans for the things that, including rate design and maybe other kinds of infrastructural issues?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think the folks on the panel are just right. There's energy and then there's the system cost. And if those are completely disaggregated, you're not getting a true pricing signal. For us, it's baby steps right now because our infrastructure is so robust compared to what demand is 90% of the time. Well, look, we only peak between 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock, in July and August, basically. And the rest of the time, we're significantly under the capacity of our distribution system and certainly our generation. And prices are relatively cheap. But just because prices are relatively cheap doesn't mean there isn't extreme value in making it more efficient. The first thing for us in our electric vehicle program is the cost of running the grid and supplying electricity isn't getting any cheaper. but demand is stagnant. And that's a good thing, right? Because we're getting distributed generation, we're getting energy efficiency, all those are good things, but that takes an old paradigm, which is cost divided by use, and it breaks it. And so I think the first thing utilities and stakeholders have to do is stretch that paradigm. If you're going to have rate design that says there's three classes, and it's a very simple equation, you know, in the end, you don't get to handle kind of this emerging ecosystem, right? The second thing is there's huge benefits for our system just in enabling electric vehicles now, because it's the last sector of the economy that isn't electrified, right? And so the load at scale that that can bring on is great. And that works. That speaks to that very simple equation, which is cost divided by usage. As we do that, though, if we don't design it to be smart, if we don't design it to be automated, if we don't design it in a way that it will interact with consumers in a way that they don't have to think about it, then we've missed the real opportunity and the next opportunity. And so the system we're putting out self-balances. I can have a distribution engineer say this set of electric vehicle charging stations will never exceed this amount of capacity during this time. Or better yet, our system can just send it a signal and say, we're feeling a little stressed, right? We would like very much not to exceed this. And then it'll just self-balance the demand there. The other thing you can do by setting up a network and connecting it to the internet, people in their home, we can set up automated charging. So truly, we've got 1,000 megawatts of wind, right? It all blows during the night in Kansas and Missouri. The pricing signal we could send, but again, nobody wants to get up at 1 o'clock in the morning to take advantage of that. There are places in the country where you can do that real-time pricing now. And I think those are all things from a rate design perspective, from a system design perspective, that we have to contemplate. And it can't be done just by us. It has to be done in concert with the folks who know how to do it. Again, we don't make the Candy Crush Saga app for this, right? We don't do that. We make the system that it operates on, and we'll leave the rest to you. So,
Brian. Yeah, maybe on the Internet of Things and electrical vehicles and buildings, just a different perspective. We use these technologies to build a new office, a new Alliander office in Duiven in the Netherlands. And that is an energy positive building.
That's awesome.
So the building generates more energy than the 1,000 people that live in the offices use on a daily basis. So we did that because we wanted to understand what it is doing to our grid, what it is doing to be a distribution systems operator. And then, you know, it's not about, you know, time of use pricing or everything, but it's now a very different game altogether. We did something else. In 2009, we implemented a charging infrastructure for electrical vehicles, but there was no demand. This was the, you know, the chicken and the egg discussion. And we get criticized, you know, because, you know, why is a utility, you know, implementing this technology, why there is no demand? And now, in the Netherlands, we have 20,000 electrical vehicles. We have, in Amsterdam, the highest density of electrical vehicles in the world, full stop.
So how did you get to that point?
Because we provided the infrastructure to the people that then could, you know, buy these electrical vehicles and charge it. So, and of course, Amsterdam is different than Chicago. We, you know, the layout of the city. So you need have, you know, we needed to have this infrastructure also on the street. Mm-hmm. We not always park the cars in the garage, you know, like you do here. So there are, of course, differences in the cities, in the different cultures, etc. But it takes vision, it takes guts to change, you know, the society, and that is, you know, the point I wanted to make. And by 2020. We will have 200,000 electrical vehicles in the Netherlands. So from an electrical vehicle perspective, we do also more. You know, we now understand all the, let's say, the standardization that you need to do. We work with all these, with BMW and Mercedes and General Motors. And then we work with the European Commission on, you know, how to speed up standardization, because, you know, often it takes 8 years to make a standard. And now we talk to NIST, you know, how can you help us, you know, making new standards? So we are now pioneering making new standards, you know, from 8 years to 8 months, based on very different, you know, paradigms. So I just wanted to you know, technology, you know, can really change the world if you look at it from a very different angle as well. And if you have a vision and the guts to put something out.
And I think it helps that, you know, people in Amsterdam are riding their bicycles even in the middle of winter.
Absolutely.
You also have a population like that.
Yeah, yeah.
But moving on to microgrids, so we've talked about Internet of Things and smart buildings and so on, and electrical vehicles and you know, what's going on in other parts of the world where you have energy positive buildings. But so let's talk about microgrids, and in the previous session this morning, Peter Kelly Detweiler already defined and explained what a microgrid is, so I'm not going to do that. But let's talk about maybe emerging models of microgrids, or what we would like to see in terms of microgrids. And John, do you want to tell us, you know, how peer might view this?
So I'll start by blowing up that definition of microgrids.
Okay.
Because I think it's too narrow. I think to say that a microgrid is this islandable, standalone, even if it's interconnected, but it's islandable. I think let's think a little bit broader. If we actually go back to the beginning of grids, they were microgrids. That's where we started. And then we started pulling them all together. So I'm going to ask you to imagine a state with no cities. Would your garbage get picked up? Would your water, how would your streets look? Just imagine how bad your local services would be without a city. But that's how we run our grid. Huge IOUs with no local representation. So I would argue that a microgrid is local representation. That in fact our grid is just a series of microgrids that we have not defined yet. So every small city, neighborhoods within Chicago, Anne actually mentioned it at lunch. She said we're in the Brownsville area designing a microgrid to provide to that community the service they need from the grid. So we see utility microgrids and private microgrids. And basically what PEER does is PEER gives you the design, operating, and verification standard to operate those microgrids at an absolute optimal level. So that they, again, like I said, you can plug in everything. You can get any power you need from the other side of the grid. And I'll give you one example. Within PEER, you get credits for distribution automation and self-healing. So now the city of Chattanooga is almost at 100% self-healing and distribution automation. Fully tree-lined overhead system, and they're down to around reliability levels that are one quarter of what they are here in Chicago. One quarter. Not only that, but that system now enables solar storage and plug-in vehicles because software talks to every switch. They can change the open in the circuit from anywhere. So as solar systems are kicking on, as storage is going in, as you're plugging in vehicles, the system's actually changing dynamically in real time using advanced software by SNC Electric that provided those super intelligent switches, which now have software that can be changed every year and updated just like the software on your phone. And so now these systems are completely different than what we think of when we think about this static. But it really goes back to this whole idea of a network of microgrids. So let's be broader.
So would it be fair to say that PEER is a way of distinguishing or assessing whether a microgrid is a good microgrid or perhaps not so good microgrid or maybe not that efficient a microgrid?
It really gives you an optimal, if you designed the PEER design, and I just like lead for a building now, but it's also designed to help you think of new things. So it's really a beginning point where, yes, it's got some initial performance standards and some design capabilities, but it's really designed to have you think about all the performance areas, safety, reliability, resiliency, as well as energy efficiency environment. Customer engagement is one of the categories within PEER, and also operational efficiency, driving waste out of the system. I hear people talk about cost. Yeah. Bob Galvin would always say, you have to constantly drive waste. It's not cost. A lot of people call things in their daily lives cost, when in fact they're waste. They're not a cost. You can drive it out of your system if you think about it as waste. So it's a different way to think about it.
But eventually, someone has to pay for the microgrid. And you know, I understand that there's a microgrid, and that people are considering a microgrid in some of the great Chicago institutions. And maybe, Ellen, you can tell us about that. And let's talk about costs and waste.
Let me give you one example. UT Austin, operating cost of $20 million a year instead of $40 million. their microgrid reduced their operating costs by 50%. If they were just operating all those buildings served by Austin Energy, the local utility, they'd be paying $40 million a year for the cooling, heating, and power that they get.
Okay, so this is a very economic example. You know, the microgrid
We see frequently 30 to 50% operating cost reduction when you look at it from a more holistically microgrid perspective.
Okay, so Ellen, why don't you tell us about Chicago? What's going on out here? Apart from IIT and all that.
One of the examples of a private microgrid being evaluated is at the Shed Aquarium. And I know the gentleman from ISTC mentioned the amazing work Shed is doing. They have a plan to reduce their energy usage by 50% by 2020, which is obviously an advanced goal for any institution, but especially one that's technically a hospital because it's a life-sustaining institution. So they have to worry about things that might never cross anyone else's mind, like keeping fish alive. And in the last couple of years, they've made amazing advances. And one of the things that they're now considering is whether a microgrid on the museum campus. So for those of you who don't know Chicago, we have a beautiful area of the lakefront that includes the Adler Planetarium, the Shedd Aquarium, the Field Museum, Soldier Field. It's all in Park District land. And there's a great deal of opportunity for these institutions to pioneer this kind of advancement. And the Shed is leading the way in that. So we embedded a Climate Corps fellow with them this summer to assess the energy demand at the Shed and some of its neighbors in the next couple of years, and then assess the capacity and the role of solar, because they've got a large solar installation there that would make a microgrid possible. And then he's also assessing the financial case, not only what the costs and returns would be, but also what tools are out there to help them implement these savings so that they can have both a reliable and a resilient program, because they do want to save money, they do want to be pioneers, but at the end of the day, their thought is, God forbid another natural disaster or anything that brings the grid down comes through, they have lives to save. So they want to make sure that they're reliable and resilient, and they're leading the way in the museum industry. I know they've spoken at a bunch of different panels on that topic, and they are giving away this knowledge for free in a lot of areas because they want to make sure that they're not the only ones that can do these things for their clients, I guess you could call them.
Yeah, and what we see in the Netherlands is that communities take it into their own hand. They pay electricity bills, and they say, what if we pool all that money together and we make a small energy company in the community? And we have 60 of them right now. So there we are, Aliander, you know, selling connections to the grid, and then, you know, they are self.
And these are cost-effective entities.
They are very cost-effective entities because they do it themselves, and they do it with renewable energy, etc. Combined heat pumps, you know, all kind of new technologies that are there, and they are, you know, basically self-sustainable. Of course, not always completely because of the lack of battery infrastructures, etc. But they are coming very close. We have experiments in vacation parks that they really can be off-grid, you know, most of the time in the winter season and in the summer season. So, you know, when you see, you know, that this is coming to you as a utility, you know, so that's why we now think about, you know, our strategy, and that is also why we think, you know, what is going on in the world and what do we need to do for our next business model.
And that sort of takes us to smart cities, and you know, that's how you got interested in smart cities, and you want all of us to become smart cities now.
Aliander with Amsterdam started a smart city initiative in 2009, and now we have 65 projects, not top down that Aliander is dictating these should be the projects, no, but bottom up. You know, the citizens, you know, say, you know, I want to do this, you know, I want this, you know, energy community, I want, you know, electrical vehicles, I want now data, you know, Amsterdam is giving, you know, open data and their hackathons, etc. So all of a sudden, you know, a couple of years into this change on renewable energy, a lot of things start to happen, and that is why, you know, working with the citizens, you know, makes a lot of sense to us in Europe, and that is also why the European Commission did set up a program, Smart Cities and Communities, and they want also to see, you know, what are other regions of the world doing.
So Bram, literally in one minute, if you can tell this audience, let's assume that most of them are from Chicago or from some city nearby, why they should be interested in smart cities. What's in it for them?
quality of life, higher disposable income.
Okay, higher disposable income. That sounds nice. So moving on to, you know, microgrids, and then we start talking about utility business models. And so we do have an expert on utility business models. And so David, do you just want to tell us about, you know, look at the different business models for microgrids and this whole thing about the DSP in New York and the DSO in California and why California is different from New York and why should we care in the Midwest?
Sure. I think it's important, and I appreciate John's description, a broader description, and certainly an appropriate description of what a microgrid is. I mean, you could go back in the traditional utility business and look at things like uninterruptible power supplies and VAR compensation at large commercial and industrial facilities as being a flavor of something that enhanced grid reliability and resiliency. And I think it's important to think about that because one of the things that's challenging for, and many of my clients are utilities, is to think about this environment where we've got this whole spectrum of different types of microgrids that may create different business values and be financed and how that value gets split between participants. But, you know, then, for example, in the UT case, like, what is the impact then on the host utility who no longer has the revenue source from that energy and may not have, you know, or have as much of an obligation to serve on the facilities that they've invested in? And this really brings into question the whole issue of what is the right regulatory model and what is the right utility business model to participate and to help foster microgrids, but not to have them be, you know, sort of erosive to the base business as it exists today. That would be bad for everyone, right? Because I think universally, no matter where you sit in the microgrid discussion, I've yet to hear anyone say everything needs to have a microgrid and everybody needs to be effectively off utility supply and we don't need that network for security and for backup and for the scaled economics. So if we look now at the two bookends, both geographically and then kind of philosophically, of the business model spectrum within the US, you've got the New York reinventing the electricity vision, or New York REV proceedings, and you've got the California AB 327 proceedings. And you know, again, I'll use your statement of the views that I represent today are mine only, they're not of my companies, or certainly of any regulatory regime. But I think if you look at it on the surface, New York is out in front of the technology uptake in the market. You know, relatively speaking, low solar penetration, low renewables integration, lower kind of technology adoption on electric vehicles that would drive some of the needs for the business model that they're embracing. But they're out in front of it, and certainly Audrey Zibelman from her background at PJM is a big driver of where they want to get to and the stakes that they want to put in the sand for the New York market. California, in comparison, is maybe not behind. You know, you have to look to someplace like Hawaii where you'd say they really got hammered by the uptake of distributed solar in terms of not being fully prepared for the impacts that was going to have on their grid or how they were going to have the regulatory regimes in place to manage it. And I'll just make an aside here. If you look globally, probably the most important thing to fostering these types of innovation and evolution to better business models, more efficient, clean energy, is having some stability in the regulatory regime. You look at Spain right now, where they've significantly curtailed their feed-in tariffs and the impact that that's had on this new energy economy. So it's very important, you know, for regulators, for innovators, for utilities, for everyone involved in this conversation to recognize that we need stability as we transition into these new business models. And in California, I think, quite frankly, you know, I think they're still in a regulatory regime that they feel like they, you know, there's a lot of bad press and a lot of really negative impacts from the deregulation of the wholesale energy markets and the energy merchant sector. And I think they're taking sort of a go slow approach of saying, we want the utilities to come back to us and tell us, you know, how do you want to set up your distribution resource planning or your DRP process? What is the amount of capacity of distributed resources, distributed energy resources that we can put on every circuit and on every specific location within the circuit? What is the methodology for how we want to pay for the uses, I like Ann's term of this, uses versus usage What do we want to pay distributed resources for the uses for those devices, whether that's voltage support or storage capabilities or other things? And I think particularly when you start looking at microgrids from a utility perspective, right now, most of the microgrids in the world are being approved where a microgrid is taking the place of network capacity reinforcement. Borrego Springs, remote area in the far northeast corner of San Diego service territory, you know, out in the middle of the desert. God knows why anybody would want to live there, but they do, and it's great that they do. And so they built a really innovative microgrid to add resiliency to the network instead of, you know, reinforcing a pretty fragile and susceptible to fire hazards sub-transmission line that they have. So we're going to continue to see these types, and I apologize, I'm talking for way too long, but we're going to continue to see these types of evolution in business models, but it's going to take a couple of things. It's going to take some level of an open dialogue around regulatory reform. It's going to take really active communication and communications amongst stakeholders as well as when we get down to actually making them work, communications between all the devices. And those are the types of things I think that are going to drive the uptake in distributed resources, microgrids, but also be able to preserve the utility model, which I think we all recognize is a very important component. I think it's gonna be, you know, ComEd has six microgrid demonstration projects. I think they run the gamut, as I understand it, of different types of value. And so I think that's that's an appropriate approach, is to try to figure out, you know, I think, again, as Yann described, let's put it on paper, let's do our homework on it, let's go build one, let's figure out if it works and where the value is. Let's have an open conversation about how we want to disaggregate that value. Is, you know, how much of it is going to be performance-based incentives to the utilities? How much is going to be shareholder value? How much is going to be, you know, customer value that we're going to share? Are we going to differentiate between customers in different locations on the grid? You know, do we have the ability to do that, to say, well, I'm going to pay you more for this microgrid and you're installing this equipment because it's more valuable to me there than it is somewhere else? That's a pretty thorny conversation, but it's going to be one that needs to happen.
Okay, so we have 3 minutes left, and you know, I promised you at the beginning that you would give your takeaway in the end. And there's one topic that you alluded to a little bit, which is the institutional barriers and market barriers and so on. There was a theme this morning where, you know, they said, well, just don't look at the higher levels, regulatory level or the federal level or the state level. Look at the regional level and look at the municipal level and the city level. So we just, you know, leave that institutional barriers. Ellen, do you just want to say one real quick thing at the local level?
Well, at the local level, I think it's all about partnerships. We work with ISTC, we work with CUB, we work with Seventh Wave, which is formerly Energy Center of Wisconsin, on everything from the new construction program they're spearheading to actually value energy as a metric in contracts, which is part of a DOE grant that they were talking about, putting innovation into actual practice and market adoption this morning. And we work on taking technologies that Energy Foundry brings to us and bringing them to the right stakeholders. So at the local level, institutional barrier for me is often the business barrier yet again. We have to make sure that inaction or the assumption that these technologies can sell themselves doesn't have us miss opportunities for both business models and the environmental impacts.
And why don't we start with the takeaways? So Yann, what's your takeaway for the audience? Real quickly,
yes,
please.
Pardon my language. I was going to say maybe we're all screwed. our customers are utilities. We're working on the Shedd Aquarium. There's a lot of stuff we're trying to do to participate on the regulatory side and on the technology side. At the end of the day, I think there's a lot of free agency, right? I mean, you know, consumers are putting smart thermostats, they're buying electric vehicles, the market of technology is going at such a clip that there's a whole bunch of stuff happening, whether the institutions that are, you know, in this room are, you know, trying to organize in a thoughtful way or not. This stuff is happening. And we're going to plan, but I think we're going to go through some really, really interesting times, hopefully through the rest of my career.
Okay. John.
Well, I think, Brahm, to add on to what Brahm said, to add on to the technology is that communities and cities are going to change things. They're coming together and they are demanding. They're all writing sustainable energy plans. I'm working on one for my city, Elmhurst, right now. they want to change the way we're getting energy right now. And so it's coming. Between the technology and the communities pushing, what they're going to demand is this platform that's going to allow them to get to the goals that they're after. And so I think we really just need a better microgrid platform that enables this technology to come in, the communities to come together, and to get access to that wind in North Dakota and South Dakota and Minnesota. You guys, just to see
and Kansas, don't forget.
And Kansas, yeah.
Yeah, for me, it's communications on two front. It's communications between party, and all of these communications are local. If you look at distribution grids and the problems that we have, it's not a city problem, it's individual circuits or feeders where, you know, potentially we could resolve issues on the grid. But we also need to take a really hard look at the communications infrastructure that we're going to use to manage these real-time interactions. It's hard enough today for a utility to say, I'm going to optimize voltage on my network using capacitor banks and voltage regulators that I own, because of the lack of visibility and accuracy in the way those networks are modeled. And when you layer on top of that the Internet of Things and all this other cool stuff, smart inverters, and I don't want to be a naysayer, but all this other stuff that we want to manage on top of that, we have got to get the communications infrastructure right to manage that distributed resource pool. Otherwise, this is just going to be a pipe dream of, you know, yeah, we think we can do this, but it's never going to come to reality.
Chuck.
I would say this is a very diverse ecosystem with a lot of different both social and economic agendas. And I think because it touches, the grid touches everybody. And I said, I think to really achieve some of the stuff we're talking about, we have to stop optimizing to our one variable, whatever that is. Whether it's the environment, whether it's microgrid, whether it's solar, whether it's whatever it is, and look at this a little more holistically to the value you want to derive from it, and then putting together, because, you know, what you just said is right. It's very hard for us to be reliable when 50%, you know, in the future of the stuff, it might not be ours to control. That, I mean, there's a worry that comes with that. So I think not optimizing to a variable, and then for everybody who's got an economic or a social agenda, just remember, dogs don't have to lose in order for cats to win, right? both sides can win and coexist peacefully, and I think there's some value in just remembering that too.
Okay, and Brian?
I see clearly two trends. I see an internet of energy coming to us, and I see also another trend that is power to the people.
Okay. Ellen, do you want the last word?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Because I want to build on what all of the gentlemen have said, but the theme of communication and the fact that it's not, it doesn't have to be losses on one side or the other. At the end of the day, businesses employ people, and we want to make sure those people have a healthy environment to live in. So all of our interests can align, and we have to make sure that the communication is aligned so that everyone sees the value that they're getting, and we can move past that's the way we've always done it, whether it's a building engineer, whether it's a utility, a large company, or an environmental organization, because we can all come together to figure this out, and we won't be able to do it any other way given the layers that we've mentioned.
So we have 9 minutes.
You, what about you? What is your conclusion?
My conclusion is basically all of your conclusions combined. we have, because we are running out of time out here, and I just want to leave some time for questions. We have about 9 minutes for questions. So, folks, if you have questions, this is, go ahead, please.
David, you mentioned your involvement with RIO, UK.
Blame it on Rio. That's all I can. Yeah, he's the question was I've had involvement with RIIO, more popularly known as Rio, which is the UK's new regulatory regime for their networks businesses. And all I can say is blame it on Rio, because it's been a real interesting ride. The transmission businesses in the UK have been under the Rio regime for about 2 years, and the distribution businesses just went in April of this year. But effectively, what it is it's a the UK was in the fifth iteration of their performance-based rate-making program, which was called DPCR5, which basically sought to drive down costs in the system by having a superset of regulatory performance indicators that each utility had to benchmark against. And Rio basically added to that to say, well, but we want to inspire innovation, and we want people to actually get a return for beginning to innovate in their networks as opposed to just driving costs down. So one of my clients, Electricity Northwest in Manchester, actually got the highest innovation allowance and funding of any utility because of a lot of their thinking about how they do low voltage automation, how they get more out of the networks that they have. So you know, I guess the only thing I can say is it's been interesting to look at changing the lens from just driving costs down to trying to figure out where can you innovate but actually get a direct return within the regulatory period from that innovation.
Go ahead, please.
First of all, Yann, I want to say that there are a few people in the smart technologies that are talking about automation, they're talking about control. So I'm glad to know that there's more people talking about automation. But the question that I have for the board would be, as a consumer at any level, should I be more concerned about the messaging, or how are you going to create the messaging to make everybody's life simpler, or about the security of the cloud? Just yesterday, the story came out that now there are people that are going on the cloud and controlling my Jeep. If you haven't heard that story, they turned the Jeep off while it was running. So when we're talking about the Internet of Things, we're talking about using the cloud, and nobody used the word cloud, by the way, I noticed that. How secure is that going to be for whether it's a smart building or a smart home or a smart car or my smart phone?
Sure. I'm just going to make a little comment. One of the things in terms of the scope of this discussion, yes, we did talk about Internet of Things, cybersecurity or security of the electronic nation in the cloud. That it's not something, it's incredibly important, and that's a whole subject that can occupy a whole conference, and it does in many instances. So we deliberately, for time purposes, did not address that. But go ahead, Brown, please.
Well. Only to say that I'm with you and that we take cybersecurity very serious. Aliander, a grid operator in the Netherlands, took the initiative to set up the European Network of Cybersecurity. A lot of scientists, you know, working on the cyber side and helping us to make our critical infrastructures that run the electricity grid cyber safe. And not only that, also including all the appliances that go into the home of the people. And it is a big challenge, and we are absolutely not out of the woods, but we are taking it seriously, and you know, this is a call for action, you know, on global basis. I think everybody needs to do that. You also need to take cyber into the equation.
I'd like to talk about the messaging question. So we have a digital efficiency platform called Efficiency Advisor, and one of the criteria for people who use it is to say, well, what are you interested in, right? So are you interested in efficiency or being green or comfort? So there might be others. But I'm not convinced, and we've done a lot of market research and focus groups, and there's a lot of diversity out there. And having a single message, which is the catch-all for the entire US population or you know whichever population, I don't believe in that. You know, we all are you know, free individuals, and we all operate differently. There's maybe a number of communities or groups, but I find that having systems that are able to self-customize to the needs or interests of, you know, that household that's using it is a big deal.
We have time for one more question. Go ahead. Could you speak a little louder, please?
Well, a lot of the utilities that we work with, first and foremost, they're looking for, can they reduce network capacity investment? So if you're going to have to build a new transmission line, or you're going to have to reinforce a transmission line, or you've got a distribution circuit that's problematic, you know, you're trying to basically offset that capital cost. That's first and foremost your driver for investigating microgrid usage. And again, I think I like the way John described it. There's a whole spectrum of value that a microgrid can provide. From purely a utility perspective, that is the, you know, the single biggest sort of business case driver. Of course, they have to be in a regulatory mechanism where they can benefit from reducing that capital investment and sort of making that optimized decision.
Yeah, and you can do that very creative. We were having a big infrastructure project with the Ajax soccer stadium and a shopping mall and a hospital. And it took us, you know, hundreds of millions, you know, to put in, you know, on capital expenditures. But then we get the CEOs together, and then we get, you know, a whole new perspective on things, and we did not need to do anything. So, you know, if you, you know, that is also, you know, something that maybe an energy, you know, company, you know, or Comet or anybody else can do. Bring the people together and think outside in, and maybe you can avoid these capital expenditures.
Yeah, and that actually, for instance, in New York, if you look at the New York REV process, one of the key drivers for that was cost. Their distribution system is an age. They have aging infrastructures. They have to make huge investments in New York. But they also have declining energy usage. So a phenomenon that was described by the previous speaker, the CEO of KCP&L. And most utilities in America face this problem. So the question is, how can you creatively use these technologies to address those very capital intensive issues?
But interestingly, in New York, so it's declining load growth, but there are pockets of load that, and it's all, you know, it's just like real estate. It's location, location, location.
Absolutely. Yeah,
so if you're a utility and you've got declining revenues because you've got reduced load growth, but you've got pockets where you've got to develop infrastructure and substations in New York City, you are very incented to try to come up with.
Absolutely. They're getting peaky at the distribution level on the non-system peaks. Mm-hmm. So, okay, with that, I think I just want to thank the panel. That was a great discussion. Thank you very much. And if you could...